Today we will take you to Holland and Eastern Europe and show you the history of the tulip. A beautiful flower with an exciting history. My name is Michael Schutte and thank you for joining us. Hello and welcome in my studio. Today it's a special day. The spring has begun, the sun is shining, and we're gonna paint flowers. Well, special flowers. And you might have understood by now, it's gonna be tulips. We got lots to do, so at work. Before we start painting the tulips, we do the background first. Colors will influence each other, so it's a good idea to work from the back to the front. Let's mix earth green with cadmium yellow light and a tiny touch of cadmium red to blush the green a bit and make it more natural. I always like to make three different tones: dark, middle and light. And with 1-inch brush we make soft crisscross brush strokes. Painting greens can be tricky, because every human being sees greens and reds different. So don't make it all too bright flashy green, it's background. And yeah, that is why I always put a bit of red to the mix to blush the green down. And yes, there are tons of green: olive green, earth green, sap green, whatever. What is green actually? Well, if we have a fresh cut lawn in the month of May, we make it wet, and if the sun shines, yes, we might say, okay, this is fresh green. Later, more over greens. In the middle, I like to keep it light, and let's decorate our fantasy bouquet with some leaves. The technique is that you push the bristles into the wet paint and give it a turn. And be advised, you might practice this. The technique goes like this: with a small square brush loaded with green and maybe two tones of green, a light one and a dark one, we start the brush stroke with the sharp end of the brush. Push, and during the move you turn the bristles slowly. If you missed it, no worries, I will do it a few more times during the painting. And as this is a fantasy bouquet, we can paint some little twigs, and to cheer it up, we can do some tiny little flowers. Maybe it's bridal veil, although this is how we call it in Holland. Let's do a few more leaves. Watch the technique. With two colors on the bristles, I push it into the wet paint and make a slight turn. Let's do this one more time. Like I said, two tones on the bristles, and it might be a dark tone and a light tone. Push it in the wet paint, make a slight turn, and very important, at the end of the stroke, absolutely no pressure. And probably you will understand that this technique needs some practice. Take a piece of oil paper and do hundreds of these guys, and you will get the hang of it. Or otherwise, if you are in the neighborhood, come by and I show you the tricks. Let's do a few more decorations, maybe some more little leaves, a few grasses, and if you like it, some little white flowers. The trick is, take a light tone and push the bristles into the wet paint and draw. The wet green underlayer will mix with the leaves, but this will make it transparent, which is so cool. We give them a dark yellow heart. And now let's be brave and start at the tulip. As we always work from the back to the front, we start with the back petals, which are cadmium red with a touch of alizon crimson. The technique of flower painting is to do the brush strokes in one move and don't come back in it, don't blend it in. we will pick up a bit of the background color, but that is okay. First, before we go on, I want to make the underlayer wet with a combination of raw, shenna and white. Let's see how that works. So let's leave it for now. And first we're going to add more shadow with a bit of purple at the inside of the right petal, just in a few strokes. And we can do a few more at the top also. Now, with a mix of the lightest ochre tone and a good amount of titanium white, we can start the light petals. And yes, I call them light, not white. We can try to paint them in one stroke and don't come back. Let's set up a few more light petals. These parrot tulips have strange shapes, but it is like it is, and the result is really fantastic. So, like I said, we do a few more of those petals, and then we will work on the spine of the front petal. We can do this with cadmium red and a bit of alizarin crimson. And down below, we can add more purple. With a square floral brush, we make upward brush strokes. The best we can do is one brush stroke at a time and no blending in. Now, how can we lighten up the edges of the red petals? Well, it will work with some dark yellow. And if we paint that on the edge, it will turn out a bit orange. Yes, pretty risky, as this is mixing on the canvas. I don't do it often, but I think it will work out fine. Using these firm brush strokes, using lots of paint, it might get a bit muddy. And yes, then we have to wait and just let it dry. If you never painted flowers before, it might be hard at the beginning. It's a very special technique, with one stroke at a time and no blending. These tulips were called the parrot tulips. Like I mentioned before, they came to Holland in the 18th century. And yes, they were pretty expensive and big too, like 5 inches, and in every color you could desire. I choose them because they're more attractive and a nice challenge for painters. Personally, I love those weird shapes and a huge variety in colors. And I got no clue why they were called parrot tulips. Maybe because of the colors? Who knows? And because they are so big, it's great to paint them. We got all the space in the world to improvise, mix and shape those beautiful tulips. Let's give this one a bit more shadow under the bud with some purple. And give it extra brush strokes too. But I think it's getting really too muddy. We have to leave it and let it dry. The only thing we can do for now on this one is adding some highlight on the light petals. We mix titanium white with cadmium light yellow and just give it a few touches just on top of the light petals. Now let's take a little break and dive into the history of the tulip. Now let's have a little chat about tulips. Everybody thinks that they came from Holland, but that's not quite true. Originally, they came from Kazakhstan. In the 1500s, a part of Kazakhstan fell in the hands of Sultan Suleiman I. He made a little walk to the mountain and he found a beautiful unknown flower. And yes, it was the tulip. He fell in love with this wonderful flower. So they were exported to Turkey in Constantinople, now Istanbul. And every year in spring, when the tulips were blooming, the Sultan organized a huge tulip party. And the tulip became a symbol for power and wealth. The Ottoman sultans wear a tulip on their turban, because tulips look like a turban. And the Persian word tulipan means turban. On a certain day, Sultan Suleiman donated some tulips to the Viennese ambassador Okir Kislin von Busbeke. Not a name but fits on a paycheck. Anyway, he donated some tulips to his friend Carolus Clusius. He was head of the Hortus Botanicus in the Dutch city of Leiden in 1593. And the first tulips started to grow in Holland. And the Hortus is the oldest botanic garden in Holland. Everybody loved them, but unfortunately, almost all the tulips were stolen. However, a tulip was discovered in Holland, and clever merchants started setting up a business in tulips, and with success. The trade exploded. I know it sounds crazy, but in 1637, a tulip bulb got the same value as a mansion at an Amsterdam canal. On this painting of Jean-Léon Jérôme, we see guards and workers weaponed with daggers and swords to protect the tulips. In 1623, one tulip bulb was worth 1,000 Dutch guilders. A yearly income from a worker like a blacksmith was 150 guilders. So you can compare. On this receipt of a trader, Peter Vos, from Haarlem, we can see that the tulip bulbs were sold for 3,000 and 4,200 guilders. And you will understand that only the super rich and famous could afford to go on with this so-called wind trade. And did it go on forever? Well, not really. It ended up in a terrible nightmare for all participants. But I will tell you more about this tulip drama later in the show. Let's first do a bit of painting on our tulips. Yes, it's quite a story. It's almost a soap opera. In the meantime, I painted the back petals, and with cadmium red and alizon crimson, we can paint the spine for the side front petals. And down below, we can make it darker with purple like we did before. We use firm brush strokes. In fact, it's not that difficult. We don't have to follow picky lines. It's almost impressionistic painting. Let's do a few more red side petals using the same color combination. Red, cadmium red, alizon crimson, and below some purple. When we go in with the light petals, it will pick up some red, which is great because of the transparency. Now watch my technique. I hold the brush at the end of the shaft and let the brush doing its work. Just a short stroke. Don't go back. I know it's tempting. I did it too. I couldn't resist it, but no, it's not a good idea. Just leave it. Later, I will show you how to repair little glitches like in the front of the spine in the red. No worries about that. Let's do more light petals at the top, at the left side. And before we forget it, we need to add a few green small lines into the light petals. We make short, thin strokes, nothing special. Just move the brush up, no pressure, no blending. Try to do this in one move and get lost. Now that doesn't sound very friendly, sorry. Amsterdam humor. It's pretty rough. Some people never get used to it. Well, we can add more highlights to the light petals. Make very short brush strokes. Nothing special, but this is a good exercise in aiming with the bristles. When you pick up some red or green, don't worry. It looks fantastic and transparent. Let's do a few more. And if you make a little mistake, no worries. Let it dry and go over it again. This is the advantage of painting with oils. With acrylics, it's a different ballgame. The left red petal has ruffles. And that is the fun part of painting. Push the bristles upwards and it will melt into the wet underlayer. And down below, we can do a bit more purple for the shadow. For now, we can give the spines of the petals extra power by adding more red and purple. try to do this in one stroke. Push the brush upwards and don't come back. Before we move on, first listen to this. If you ever need some help with mixing colors or sketching, you're always welcome in our lesson center in Parksville. As you might know, I love to donate paintings which I made for this show to the North Island Wildlife Recovery Center in Errington, a lovely place to relax and watch all the animals who are recovering from accidents or who are there because of other reasons. Of course, you will meet Ray and Knut, and you can measure yourself with the size of bears or take a look in the baby room where the kids have a good time sweeping the floor with all kinds of logs. Or just walk around and relax and having a good time. Yes, it's always a great place to relax and have some fun. Or take a sketchbook, sit down and start sketching. We have one more tulip to do. As always, we start with the back spines using cadmium red and purple. Then we paint the side petals with a light tone. We make short brush strokes, and yes, we will pick up some red, but that will work out wonderful. Let's do a few more on the right side, and then in the middle of the petals, we brush in a few green brush strokes. Here we make them a bit bigger because it's all background. We can make three spines, and by now you know what to do. Cadmium red, alizon crimson and purple. With a square brush we can make firm brush strokes, and don't forget to use some medium. The front one is a bit more rough, but that's the fun part, making everything uneven. Down below the spine we can paint a few outstanding petals, which is really cool. Later we will add light on them. Don't forget to use a square brush. And talking about brushes, sometimes students ask me, Michael, what is the best paint? What is the best canvas to paint on? And more important, what are the best brushes? And that is a very difficult question. My advice is try everything out. And I mean everything, all brands, and look what fits the best for you. For me, it's very personal. And students who painted with me before know my answer already. Always buy the best materials that you can afford. Never buy the cheapest stuff, it will disappoint you. And certainly watch out with canvases. A good advice is buy with a store where you get a good, decent advice. I think this will help you to move forward with the fun of painting. And the more you paint, the more experience you will build up. You will get your own preference for certain brands. Even when I'm on holiday, I always look for art material stores and see what they have to offer. In the meantime, I built up the third tulip. And yes, this one is a bit more complicated. I made the petals in the front a bit more lighter and the back darker to create more contrast. Then we go into the green again and move it up into the wet paint of the light petals. On the left side of the flower we can add another spine. Yes, I call them spines. This is what it is. And go in again with the light petals. This left wing, let's call it a wing, makes a slight turn to the left. Then we bring in the green decoration, and yes, I call it decoration. Sorry, I give all items stupid names, but as long as you understand what I mean, we're good. We can do a few more brush strokes, but it's getting pretty wet and muddy, so I think we better leave it drying for a while. Maybe we can add more purple below to create more shadow. And like I said before, the brush strokes need to be firm and short, and absolutely no blending. And you know what? I almost forgot the stamps. With two tones of green, a light and a dark one, we can do this in one sturdy move like this. Maybe two. Later we can always add more light or dark. Now let's take a look at the total. Well, it's not too bad, but we have to do a final touch. We will do this later. Let's take a break and look at the history of the Tulip part 2. Yes, on a dark Tuesday evening, February 3, 1637, this so-called wind trade collapsed. Probably pressured by the public opinion, nobody paid these ridiculous prices anymore from one day to another, and it became a drama. Rich merchants had to sell their homes, businesses, and ended up living on the street, with sheds full of worthless tulip bulbs. The history of this tulip madness can be found in a book written by Charles Mackay in 1841. It's called The Extraordinary Popular Delusions and the Madness of Crowds. A very interesting book. Anyway, Holland tulips became among famous by this man, by this famous singer and our good friend Herman Hemming. Now listen to this.
Als de lente komt, dan stuur ik jou tulpen uit Amsterdam. Als de lente komt, pluk ik voor jou tulpen uit Amsterdam. Als ik wederkom, dan breng ik jou tulpen uit Amsterdam. Duizend gele, duizend rode wensen jou het allermooiste wat mijn mond niet zeggen kan. Zeggen tulpen uit Amsterdam.
We were watching a typical Dutch party from years ago when I was a professional musician. With our famous band, the Holland Quartet, we accompanied all famous Dutch stars in theaters, dinner shows and cruises, and last but not least, Herman Hemming. And yes, the guy on the right is your teacher when he was still young and pretty. Anyway, we had lots of fantastic performances with Herman. He even performed in Canada and made the Dutch tulips famous. But also in Canada, we can admire the beauty of this magical flower. Like here in Abbotsford. Lots of tulips. And what do you think of Chilliwack, close by? And I'm not a patriot, but there are lots of Dutch farms over there. And don't forget the Tulip Festival in Ottawa, the Canadian Tulip Festival. A wonderful festival with tulips everywhere, like a modern version of the Turkish festivals in medieval times. Well, it was quite a story. Let's shut off with these wonderful pictures from Holland and let's go back to our masterpiece. Yes, that is so cool. As you might know, I love trains. We let the painting dry for a while and let's put up some highlights on several important spots, like the top of these petals. I use a small round brush and my hand is leaning on a pallet stick. Now watch this, this is gonna be cool. We're gonna paint a water drop. The top part is dark with a bit of purple. And down below we add a light ochre tone. In the dark we put up a highlight and yes, we have a water drop with a bit of shadow below. It's a cool technique, but I advise you to practice this before you do the real thing. Let's go to the second tulip. I made the front petal a bit darker with ochre and a tiny bit of purple. And with a square brush, we can set up more highlights. And see how much you want to do, but we have to go to the last tulip because time is running out. In fact, it's the same technique. First, we place the highlights where it's necessary, and for the overall balance of the flower, it might be a good idea to do a light petal on the left side. First a few on the top, and then we have to be brave. We take a light tone, a square brush, and then in one move, now make it two, we put up that petal and it's looking good. Some green underneath, and this gives a nice natural shadow. It's looking good. We can repair the spine with a bit of purple and red. And I got a cool idea to do some more decoration under the tulips, just for the balance of the overall result. First, we draw with a small round brush a few little twigs, and we can use dark green and a tiny bit of purple. Just fantasize how much you want to do. With a light ochre tone, we can do a few of those cute little tiny flowers, which are so easy to do. In all honesty, I prefer to do this wet and wet, but as we had to wait a day, the underlayer of green was dry. But it doesn't matter, it's the most easy technique of painting little flowers, and as long as the result is good and we're having fun, it's all okay with me. So feel free to add more petals or flowers or whatever you want, our time is up. And if you ever want to try it yourself, remember what I said, drop me a line and I will see how I can help you. Enjoy! We just finished our bouquet of tulips. Thank you for watching, check out our website, and I hope to see you back in my next show, and then I will have some breaking news for you. So, till the next time, and keep on painting!